initially you were arguing on the grounds that the legislature didn't follow the proper procedures. Is there a reason you took that route as opposed to maybe hammering harder on the Second Amendment?
Well, the Second Amendment arguments that we're going to make are not for this case. You know, those substantive rights of whether or not this restriction goes too far and violates the U.S. constitutional principles is a significant issue. And the state wanted to desperately try to bring that issue in front of the court today. As again, it's like a red herring. But these matters that we've raised in this state court case are procedural and substantive issues, so as it relates to the Illinois Constitution, which need to be vetted just as vigorously as U.S. constitutional principles.
You're asking the judge for a temporary restraining order, an injunction, basically. What exactly will you go from here to get that injunction?
Well, the judge took it under advisement. He's going to issue that ruling sometime between now and close of business on Friday. And all we're asking him to do is during the interim is to treat our clients the same as these, again, tens of thousands of citizens who have been exempt out of this law for based upon reasoning that doesn't make any sense.
Your clients are, by the way, because it's hard to hear in the back.
I have 866 clients. Four of them are licensed FFL dealers, and the other 862 are citizens of the state of Illinois.
Let's talk specifically about those plaintiffs. 866, that is such a large number. Now, you do have several gun shops that are included in that you've made a strong argument. You know, they're the ones that could be impacting in terms of sales, which the opposition also said that there could be an amount that they lose business there. But their argument, it was very contradictory to what you said, because they said, well, they could lose a little bit of money, but they could still sell to certain people that could buy these weapons. Big difference compared to the people that are individual gun owners, right?
It's kind of, but keep in mind there, again, they're trying to change the conversation in a way that they think helps them. Because it's all about, again, as it relates to the ability to sell, an equal protection is these particular individual businesses are being restricted in their ability to sell, but every exempt person is not restricted in their ability to sell. So raising that equal protection argument, there is the harm that we're getting to in that disparate treatment, and they're trying to turn it into a dollar value calculation, which is an inappropriate standard. It's a red herring.
Now, you've known the legislative process for a bit now, and we've become buddies over time covering you in court. You know that there's gun replace every single year in Springfield. This is nothing new. People do that for the budget bills. They do that for trailer bills, we like to call them in Springfield. How is this any different than any of those bills in the past? And are you saying that there's a long-term problem in Springfield that needs to be addressed?
It's absolutely a long-term problem. This gut and replace that we've raised in this case, you're absolutely right. It's been going on for a long time, but what we've gotten to now is that it's been allowed to go on for so long and it's become so pervasive that they're using it for bills that are having significant impact on people's rights under the Bill of Rights of the Illinois Constitution. Just think if we were talking about a law that was limiting freedom of speech for the media. That would be a topic that would be very sensitive to everybody here standing with a camera in front of me, and so they would take that very seriously. This is a Second Amendment issue of the Constitution, but it's also an Illinois constitutional issue too of the right to bear arms. So it's a very serious issue, and if we're going to impact rights that are significant, it needs to be done in a manner that's open and transparent, and then the public's representatives have ample time to participate. And you even heard the judge say today, what record do we have to know what the intent of this legislation was? We don't have one because of the way that they adopted this law.
You listed four reasons why that TRO should be granted. Which one do you think will win your case or in this TRO? Would you think the equal protection or the due process? Which one do you think sticks out the most?
Which one sticks out the most in the short term is probably the equal protection argument. All four of them have their own merit. All four of them are going to require the vetting at different levels. But keep in mind, for today, we only have to show that there's a likelihood of success. And again, the equal protection argument for me is, and again, this equal protection argument can be made in the federal court as well as the state court. Because you have equal, as you heard today in argument, equal protection applies in the federal and the state court. So our federal case, and I'm assuming a couple of them are coming, you know, the Illinois State Rifle Association didn't raise equal protection in their case. I don't know why, but there is no reason to create these disparate categories. And I'm telling you, I know why they created these categories. They created these categories, and I'm not being disrespectful to our public unions, but most of them have a connection to the public unions who absolutely put a lot of pressure on the legislature to carve them out of this bill. And that's wrong. I'm sorry. It's wrong. My individual or my client's individual rights to bear arms are no different than a man or a woman that happens to work in the prison system or works in armed forces. If they're trained, fine, I understand that. But there are citizens who are also trained, and you're carving them out. And again, the training was just something that they, the defendants today, tried to use as a basis to justify the exemption. That's all they had. But at the end of the day, it doesn't pass muster because, as I told you guys when we were arguing, I don't know what the intent of this bill was, but they kind of say in their argument they're trying to limit access to these types of weapons. If you assume that's true, what does training have to do with that? Has nothing to do with it. So they're really stuck on the equal protection issue. I don't think there's a good argument that they have.
If you get the TRO, would they be allowed to resume sales until further hearings?
Yes.
Now, and would it apply just to your clients or would it apply statewide?
Just to the people listed in this case.
There are some people online right now that are seeing this specific case and also seeing the Illinois State Rifle Association one that's going to a federal court, and they feel that that one is more important because it would take a larger amount of people that could impact with the whole state. How do you argue that yours is still important to people across the state?
Well, I think they need to read that case and actually go through and see what it says and what it doesn't say. I wouldn't agree with their assumption, so they probably ought to pay a little more attention to what the State Rifle Association... I'm not discrediting what they filed. I'm just saying that it doesn't... It could potentially have broad implications down the road, but in the at the early stages of that, it's not much different than ours, other than they have raised the federal issues. And they really, if you want me to give a little bit of speak to it, they get into the dirt about what constitutes an assault weapon and what doesn't constitute an assault weapon. There's reasons that those types of cases languish in the federal courts for years when they get muddled down with some of those arguments. And if we're looking right now to take a quick look at this law and say it's not right, it's not fair, it's inequitable, these state court arguments in the short run are going to be a lot more effective. That's my opinion, but again, people can file whatever they think they want to file.
You mentioned several times today that Senate President Harmon and Speaker Welch didn't have any representation today. What do you think of that?
You know, that's interesting. We were talking about that upstairs. So we have four defendants. We have Attorney General Raul, Governor Pritzker, Speaker of the House Christopher Welch, and Senate President Don Harmon. The Attorney General's office only entered their appearance on behalf of the governor and on behalf of the Attorney General. There was no representation here today for the Speaker of the House or President Harmon. I think the people of Illinois ought to pay attention to that, because if they're so adamant that the way they're passing these procedural issues is proper, why weren't they here defending themselves?
Anything else you'd like to add?
No, ma'am.
All right.